seagrass ecosystems cover some 200,000 square kilometers. They provide the base for one of the most productive and biodiverse ecosystems on Earth, rivaling coral reefs and rainforests in terms of ecosystem services. For example, nurseries for young fish and other organisms, protection of the coastline from erosion, and maintenance of water clarity. An international consortium of 35 labs led by Janine Olsen has now published the genome of the seagrass Zostera marina in the scientific journal Nature.
It's very exciting for us because seagrasses are the only flowering plants that have returned to the sea. And there are some 260,000 species of flowering plants, but only about maybe 1,000 have gone back to freshwater conditions, and only 60 have gone back into the ocean. And that's a very difficult transition from an evolutionary perspective, physiological perspective, that has occurred only 3 times in evolutionary history over, say, the last, 120 million years. And so for us to be able to look at what changes have occurred in the genome that have allowed this back transition is extremely exciting and has many scientific applications as well as practical ones.
Eelgrass is the most widely distributed seagrass throughout the Northern Hemisphere, ranging from southern Portugal to northern Norway. The genome, therefore, provides a unique resource for investigating adaptation under climate warming, as well as for unraveling the mechanisms of salinity tolerance.
From an eco-evolutionary perspective, so from, say, the more pure science side of things, we're really interested in how evolution and ecology feed back on one another. And so this opens up a number of kinds of studies that involve the interactions of genes and gene networks in natural conditions. But there are also some very nice applied aspects to seagrass research. And one in particular is understanding and developing early warning indicators for seagrass health, so to speak. And that's important because seagrasses are threatened worldwide by human activities, not just climate change in that sense, which is also one we're interested in, but also because of habitat loss and fragmentation. And as you noted earlier, there are many ecosystem services provided by seagrass ecosystems which we don't want to lose.